It happens late at night, after 10 and before 4. It's called patient dumping.
Wait, so y'all just gonna leave this lady out here with no clothes on? That is not okay.
Due to the circumstances of what it was.
Then you all need to call the police. So you all are just gonna leave this lady out here like this? Are you in pain?
For any society, just to drop somebody off in the middle of the night, and especially with a disability, and expect them to fend for themselves is really barbaric. And if a hospital wants to make the most profit, they want to get the most number of people in the beds. So to get somebody out and get the next person in, find a place, dump them off. Because if your heart really is to help those in need, on the one hand, but on the other hand, if somebody else's heart is profit, how can you reconcile those two?
We've had people who have arrived literally in scrubs and open-toed sandals from mental health units where there's been a sort of discharge meeting at sort of 10 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the afternoon. They're put in a taxi and sent down to us. Last year we had a man who had been discharged from the local hospital 9 days after having open heart surgery.
Hi, I'm Emily, a talent community manager at United Health Group. Here at United Health Group, we're providing healthcare to over 90 million people worldwide.
Hi, I'm Allison, and I just became eligible for Medicare, so I signed up for a Humana Medicare Advantage and prescription drug plan. I'm excited.
The NHS has been repurposed from a public service to something for profit extraction. And all the changes we have seen have just been about liberating up these potential assets for the corporate raiders to take them over.
Healthcare is
a multi-trillion dollar opportunity, if you listen to any of the lobbyists. It is. I mean, globally, if you look at it, it is a huge, huge market, potential market. And the NHS stands out as a 120-odd billion pound opportunity. Yeah. Lobbyists normally lobby for one or two reasons, a threat or an opportunity, and the NHS is a nice, juicy opportunity.
We share in the risk of ill health together. It's a joint project. We fund it together. We share that cost fairly. That's the essence of the NHS. What's truly worrying about the way in which the NHS is moving is that that whole essence is being fractured and undermined by the involvement of the private sector and by the underfunding process.
If things continue unchecked, and this really is a juggernaut which is accelerating and seems to be in its final stages, then we will end up, I think, and we already are, in a situation where there's a two-tier system. You will never abolish the NHS. The NHS simply becomes eventually, ultimately, a third-class basic service.
The biggest open secret in Britain is that the National Health Service, the NHS, is under attack. This war on a unique institution is not new, but has entered a dangerous new stage. In 2019, more of the NHS was sold to private firms than ever before. The term privatization is seldom used, its reality concealed in corporate spin, in deceitful words like reform and partnership. Of course, the NHS may look and feel the same, and it works often brilliantly, but it's changing fast. with hospitals forced to compete and profit-making companies cutting back on vital services, especially to the vulnerable. This film is a tribute to an institution that gave freedom from fear to millions, the first of its kind in the world, a last bastion of true public service. It's also a film about democracy. Above all, it's a warning. This is Michael and Matthew Moncrief, who lost their father, Trevor, to a heart attack. Age 66, Trevor Moncrief lived in Melton Mowbray in Leicestershire. He died after an ambulance from a private company, Amvale, answered a 999 call to his home.
The ambulance pulls up and they've gone in to the house and seen Matthew performing some rudimentary first aid on my father. At which point they've taken out their machine, taken out the defibrillator, charged it up. Things look like they're going okay. And at the point at which they try to administer a shock, the defibrillator fails, causing great consternation amongst the staff, and that they need a new defibrillator on site as soon as possible, but they're unable to get hold of the people who can dispatch that. A text is sent to a call centre.
They left messages with the call centre and text in the middle of an emergency.
Absolutely. So no one directly spoke to someone who would actually be able to dispatch a new ambulance with a working defibrillator. The ambulance staff recommend that my brother calls the fire service to get a defibrillator on hand, because they're known to keep them on their trucks. And the fire service are dispatched to my father's address, and they arrive and they do have a defibrillator. But obviously this is all contributing to a general scene of chaos. This is all valuable time that's being lost in an extremely critical period of a heart attack. We're still yet to hear back from the call centre at this point. So the situation's kind of descended into a harrowing farce.
There followed confusion about which hospital to take Mr. Moncrief. He was taken first to Grantham and stabilised, then to Lincoln, a heart specialist centre, a journey of 45 minutes.
Every subsequent action kind of went wrong. Feels as if there was nothing in place to account for this eventuality, and that from that point onwards, we just entered this kind of Kafkaesque nightmare of poor decision after poor decision after poor decision, which we are certain led to his untimely passing.
A report by a leading cardiologist found that Trevor Moncrief most likely would have lived had he received the proper emergency care.
And what we have here is defibrillators that have been bought secondhand that haven't been tested effectively or properly for many a month because they haven't purchased the devices with the manufacturer's guidelines, which smacks of cutting corners. It smacks of people trying to cut costs, to make profit, and not to provide the best care for people who desperately need it.
In 2018, the NHS in England spent more than £92 million on private ambulances and taxis for patients. Many carry the NHS logo, but look closely. Often unknown to the public, private ambulances are frequently sent to emergencies. In 2019, the Care Quality Commission warned that patients were put at risk by private ambulances. East Midlands Ambulance Service, which employed Amvale, apologised to the family. They declined to give an interview. A Freedom of Information search has since revealed that Amvale was still in service in the East Midlands in 2017, 3 years after the death of Trevor Moncrief. Keith Salt waited almost a year for a gallbladder operation. He was in constant pain. In 2013, he was offered the procedure in a private hospital, Spire Parkway in Solihull. The NHS would pay for it. A feature of privatisation is that thousands of NHS operations are outsourced to private hospitals, many of which do not have the same facilities as the NHS, the same expertise, and the same responsibility if something goes wrong. Unlike the NHS, private hospitals like Spire Parkway have slick corporate advertising. When did you find out that something was wrong?
When I actually came round in intensive care, and they were standing at the consultant was standing over saying as that experienced problems, and that was the reason for why I was where I was.
What was the result of this mistake?
He nipped the bile duct. It was a 75% cut in it, and I had one of the worst injuries of a bile duct that you could have without, I suppose, dying. When I did delve into what these kind of injuries do, a lot of people in a few years back was quite bad, and a lot didn't survive beyond 12 months with this kind of injury.
I'll just get this right. Dr. Mercer, the specialist who rescued the situation,
yeah,
I suppose, he came from the NHS hospital.
The QE, yes.
Yeah, the QE.
Queen Elizabeth. But it isn't until later that you suddenly realise that, unlike an NHS hospital, when there is a problem, they haven't got the backup to call on at that particular time, as you do in an NHS hospital, where they've got probably several in the same field that they can call on at that time.
Had you known this before, would you have gone over to it?
I was desperate at that time to just get it done, yeah. I was in that much pain.
Do you think the NHS should send patients like yourself to private hospitals?
Well, I thought it was good at the time. I mean, I was quite impressed in the fact that going into a private hospital as opposed to when you saw the surroundings and what was...
Why were you impressed?
Just simply because the difference in what you were getting, for even the rooms, the reception areas, the facilities. It was just so impressive for somebody who only ever went to an NHS hospital as to what suddenly you were being given.
So it looked good?
It looked good, yeah. Didn't end up being good, but it looked good.
In 2015, following Keith Salt's operation, the Care Quality Commission published this report on Spire Parkway. 4 years later, Spire Parkway's safety and surgery were rated good, but the hospital still requires improvement. Did Spire Parkway Hospital ever apologise to you?
No.
Did the surgeon who did it, did he ever apologise to you?
No.
I'm proud about the National Health Service. It's a piece of real socialism. And there is nowhere in any nation in the world, communist or capitalist, any health service to compare with.
The National Health Service was not a gift from above. It was conceived in the blood, sweat and tears of ordinary people who had built the imperial might and wealth of Britain and yet often lived in abject poverty. In the 1920s and 30s, modern healthcare was a luxury children died from Dickensian diseases. Women still died in childbirth. Infection ravaged slums without running water and sanitation. Britain's deadly disease was class. The Second World War was a political awakening for millions of ordinary men and women. In 1942, a committee chaired by the economist William Beveridge warned that the war was a revolutionary moment. The elite were worried. What would happen when the soldiers came home? For many Britons, the war had been fought not only against fascism, but for a new Jerusalem of decent homes and jobs and healthy lives. The Beveridge Report proposed a welfare state and the world's first national health service. Winston Churchill and the Conservatives opposed it. In the 1945 general election campaign, the war hero Churchill was not always welcomed in the industrial heartland.
Can you hear me? When we are asked what is our policy, I can only tell you that an enormous mass of work. Very substantial advances in the human heart and the human head will have to be made before we can adopt the full glorious utopias which the socialist wool gatherers placed before us.
The utopian wool gatherers would soon have their say at the ballot box, representing the majority of Britons. The soldiers' paper, the Daily Mirror, called for a vote for them, meaning the men and women who had won the war and the right to a new freedom, said the Mirror, of equal opportunities and robust health. Labour's landslide victory was a shock. And the tremors didn't stop there and became open rebellion. In the Far East, 50,000 airmen went on strike in more than 60 Royal Air Force bases, the greatest mass mutiny in British history. The issue was democracy and the right to be demobilized and not to be part of an imperial presence east of Suez. Arrested and court-martialed, the strike leaders were set free after a public outcry that symbolized a Britain that was now changing fast. On July the 5th, 1948, the most momentous social change of all was announced by this leaflet delivered to every household.
This leaflet is coming through your letterbox one day soon, or maybe you have already had your copy. Read it carefully. It tells you what the new National Health Service is and how you can use what it offers. Study the leaflet, then keep it by you. You'll need it for reference.
The NHS was founded in 1948 to give people freedom from fear of healthcare bills at a time of great need and distress. And that fundamental principle of freedom from fear on the basis of a national health service providing healthcare for all throughout the UK on the basis of need, not ability to pay, and free at the point of delivery,
That's been an enormous and immense and an important achievement.
I mean, my father was a general practitioner in the 30s. He became absolutely convinced that that system, which was effectively a market in health, people had to pay. He hated asking for payment from people he knew couldn't do it. He looked on 1948 as a day of freedom when he no longer had to ask people to pay. We had something principled and almost lovely. There was a relationship between the doctor and the patient, the one-on-one, all-important relationship, nurse and patient, which is really the essence of healthcare, was one that there was no market interference, no market exchange.
Creating an ethos that you were part of something greater than yourself, it is actually a collective act of genius from 1948 to 58 to 68. I was born in 68, and I was born in a country with almost the best infant mortality rate in the world, the best place to be born. Now, I was born in a city which had the first baby incubators, you know, there. We were at the very forefront of health.
But in the 1970s, a secret plan to sell off nationalised industry was drawn up as Margaret Thatcher prepared to take power. Nicholas Ridley, a close ally of Thatcher on the far right, advised a preparation for return to the private sector by stealth. In the same year, the American management consultants McKinsey and Company proposed that NHS hospitals should be like hotels and charge patients a daily rate. What is the history of this revisionism of the NHS?
The real attack, the real decimation started in the late 80s under Margaret Thatcher and her two advisors, Oliver Letwin and John Redwood.
How did they express that?
They produced a document called Britain's Biggest Enterprise, and this set out how to get from a public service to an insurance-based system. They knew that whatever they did to the NHS, if they took it away from a public service, there would be a huge backlash. So key to the plan was to do it very surreptitiously and covertly and over a long period of time.
But it was the new Labour government of Tony Blair that accelerated the sell-off. Blair used an accountancy trick called Private Finance Initiative, or PFI. New hospitals were effectively owned by the companies that built them under disastrous pay-later terms.
The effect of PFI has been to deliberately burden hospitals with huge debts, and these debts were structured in such a way that they would become more onerous over time. And what that does, it removes money away from the delivery of care, because PFI repayments are ring-fenced, so money has to go to pay the PFI above any other call on that money. So you end up having the servicing of the debt in preference to the providing of care for patients. And we've seen hospitals closed down. Neighbouring hospitals which don't have a PFI debt have been sacrificed to bail out hospitals with PFI debts. So if you look at the total PFI debt within the NHS, we've borrowed about $11 billion and we're going to be paying back in excess of $80 billion over 30 to 40 years.
Mm. And much of this was secret, wasn't it?
The way PFI was introduced, it was never explained in a way that the public could understand what a con, what a fraud this was.
At one point, the Labour government at one point was looking at, actually, I think it was about a third of the NHS assets were going to be effectively privatised in this way and handed over to PFI.
And were these deals accountable, publicly accountable?
They were profoundly secretive. I mean, you couldn't get any access to what was going on at all. They were all behind closed doors.
It's an enormous, appalling public scandal. 124 hospitals and more are now built, designed, built and operated using private finance. And remember, it was accompanied by one of the biggest hospital closure programs and land disposal programs.
In the late 1990s, Labour's Health Secretary, Alan Milburn, declared his undying love for the NHS.
This is a once-in-a-lifetime opportunity for the NHS to redesign its services around its patients. We've got more money going in, and that will allow us now to get the basics right, to get more nurses, more doctors, more beds in the system. But if we're going to get the best from the money, and we're going to get the best for the patient, then there has to be some big changes.
What the changes concealed was the beginning of a sell-off. The Blair government pushed through Parliament a series of bills that opened the door to private business and PFI. Having overseen the changes to the NHS, Alan Milburn left the government and later joined the board of Bridgepoint Capital, a private equity company.
Welcome to Care UK.
In 2010, Bridgepoint bought Care UK, one of the biggest healthcare companies contracted to the NHS.
Which balances making a profit and delivering quality NHS services.
This is Simon Stevens, Tony Blair's health advisor. In 2004, Stevens stepped into the revolving door and was hired by the American health industry giant United Health.
United Health Group believes that businesses and consumers will want to do business with us because we hold integrity at such a high level.
Integrity isn't hard. It's living our beliefs, it's being ethical, it's being honest.
Honesty, integrity, maybe. But United Health has another reputation. Its former chief executive, William Maguire, known as Dollar Bill, was forced to give back $620 million in the biggest share scandal in corporate history. Thank you. After 10 years with United Health, Simon Stevens was brought back by the coalition government as head of the National Health Service in England. Under the coalition government, the budget of the NHS was cut from an average annual increase of 4% to 1%. Thousands of doctors and nurses have left the NHS, which now has one of the lowest bed capacities in Europe. In the NHS today, one American company stands out, McKinsey, the management consultants with a worldwide reputation for helping governments reform public services.
If you look at the documents that I've got from around 2010-11, so this is when they really ramp up the privatisation, the reforms of the NHS, and you look at McKinsey's involvement there, they are attending meetings of the management board, the steering group that sets up these new structures within the NHS. This is a McKinsey document. It's about designing the new system, and they have set the agenda here. This is a great document. This is them discussing the new organisational design. So you have an American healthcare model. So they're looking at Kaiser Permanente. It's lots of glossy pictures of Kaiser Permanente, smiling patients and doctors.
I think the management of the NHS have become dependent on the management consultants. I think it seems to be no longer does a management ever sit down and actually draw up its own plans. They actually bring in somebody else. And at the end of the day, all you're getting is, you know, the management consultancy kind of approach in which, you know, you come along, you know, you ask a management consultant the time, he borrows your watch, tells you the time, charges you £1,000. And we've got that right across the NHS, you know.
This is the centre of Britain's democracy, Westminster. Unknown to many of us, a network of pressure groups, lobbyists, and right-wing propagandists have their offices in the streets that border Parliament. Their target is the National Health Service. Tamazin Cave and I are taking a tour. Okay, and this humble abode just round from Parliament is the Institute of Economic Affairs. Tell me about them.
The IEA is an incredibly effective propaganda machine. You look at the size of it, it's not a big, massive advertising company or lobbying agency. It's a small organisation. But the relationship it has with the media is incredibly tight. So it manages to get its messages into the tabloid press, it's all over the internet, but particularly the BBC. We do know from other sources that it has taken money from the tobacco companies. So for somebody like Philip Morris, the huge tobacco giant, they described the IEA as particularly useful in getting its messages out into the public domain. Yeah. The NHS represents everything that the IEA stands against. So it is a public institution, but right now it has some friends in very high places.
Okay, we're now in Tufton Street.
It's worth noting that Tufton Street is kind of like this epicentre for these kind of think tanks. Yeah. You've got the, you know, low tax advocates over there, you've got your climate change deniers over there, you've got your privatisers over there, your deregulators, they're all here. It's brilliant. And in the middle of it, you've got the Centre for Policy Studies, which this was Margaret Thatcher's think tank. So these are the offices of another free market think tank. Business lobby group. It's called Reform. And this is one of the, it's sort of a younger version of the CPS, basically. Mm. And it was set up specifically to lobby for privatisation of public services. So not just the NHS, but education and justice and the like. Mm. The brilliant thing about Reform, very clever this, they set up a kind of front group. So it wasn't enough that they were then saying the corporate messages in the press, they set up another group. They set up a thing called Doctors for Reform, which brilliantly was led by a GP, one who specialised in Botox, but
distinguished specialist.
Exactly. And he can reach parts of the media that a think tank can't.
They're all round the honeypot, aren't they? They're all close to power because just down the road there is the Department of Health.
Yeah, I mean, we are... Imagine the corporate interests lined up. They are literally behind the Department of Health. It's very, very handy.
OK, here we are in Bressington Place, just off Victoria Street. Portland House. What's in there?
This is the office of the trade body for all the companies, all the other companies that are looking to get their hands on NHS money, so all the big outsourcers. You've got in there Care UK, biggest NHS contractor there is at the moment. You've got Virgin, they picked up £2 billion worth of NHS contracts in the last 5 years. You've got Bupa in there, hundreds of million pounds of NHS work. And there's the arm of the biggest US health insurer, which is called United Health. Their tech arm, Optum, is a member of this organisation as well. It's called the NHS Partners Network. And it paints itself as kind of part of the NHS family. They are investing in influencing the government. It is an investment they made, a tactical investment, because it delivers a return.
I spoke to a leading lobbyist, Andrew Haldenby.
The health service is a public service. Why should it be privatised?
I think the health service is a lot more of a public-private mix than people may sometimes think, and actually was right back at the beginning. So, GPs, a very, very crucial part of the health service, have always been independent contractors in effect. They have their contracts with the NHS. But in many ways, the main thing I have to say is that the health service is this mix. It's this mix of public financing and a lot of private delivery one way or other that has built the health service we have today with its strengths and weaknesses. And I really strongly think that it should continue to be that mix going forward.
But reformers advocated, for example, the introduction of payment in the health service. I think you called it a membership charge. And the people staying overnight in NHS hospitals should pay a hotel charge.
The idea of a sort of membership fee was put forward by Norman Warner, who is a Labour peer. Well, he was trying to answer the question in a pamphlet for us. How do we get citizens of this country to take their health more seriously? So he suggested, just as an idea, a £10 a month, if you like, membership fee, which is, you know, not a huge amount, but it would be enough to sort of give people, if you like, a sort of personal stake in thinking about their own healthcare. So certainly, if we think of something like technology, which will be absolutely core, it's already core, always has been core, but even, you know, going forward, it's very exciting to think what new technology can do to the delivery of healthcare that, you know, at present can only really be done in partnership with the private sector.
The new IT system in the health service was installed by private companies and was a total catastrophe.
Well, yes. I think there may be one minor thing that came out of it, so we can say nearly a total catastrophe.
All this wheeling and dealing behind closed doors fed into the 2012 Health and Social Care Act, which promoted privatisation and changed the NHS as never before.
It's a very large act. It's over 450 pages long. And it's really the act that enables both the dismantling of the old system that was in place from 1948 and a switch to a newer system which is much more modelled on the US healthcare system, systems of the US.
See, people watching this will be shocked to hear that their health service has been and is being dismantled.
One of the founding duties on the Secretary of State in 1948 was the duty to secure and provide health services throughout England for everybody. And that's the duty that has been abolished. That duty to provide has gone. The Secretary of State has a much weaker duty to promote a comprehensive health care, but the duty to provide services in accordance with the Act has gone. And as well as that, there is now a requirement to contract, a duty to arrange services instead, which is really legalese for contracting. And the way in which our government and NHS England is choosing to interpret it as commercial contracting.
This external market created by the Conservative and Liberals in the Health and Social Care Act was a monstrous piece of legislation. It was also a grotesque lie on the British public. Both the Conservative Party and the Liberal Party went out of their way in the election to say that they were not going to have another top-down health service, and they produced the biggest and the most revolutionary change in the National Health Service throughout its history in the 2012 Act. Cameron went on to say it's the biggest mistake he made, and here it is, 6 years later, still creating serious damage to the health service.
The biggest lie is that somehow markets and competition will improve healthcare. We know from all the evidence that's available that the more you privatise the system, the more you introduce waste and you introduce conflicts of interest. So that is a big lie. The NHS prior to the Thatcher reforms, the administrative costs were estimated to be less than 5%. But we know now, best estimates are, that the cost of the market bureaucracy is running in the order of 20%. So that is 15% diverted away from the delivery of care. The beauty of the NHS came from its simplicity. And you had money coming from the Treasury to health authorities, and this was divided out between the hospitals and the GPs. There was no need for this army of intermediaries we now have.
The NHS crisis, which is no longer a winter crisis, it's an all-year-round crisis. And that's how privatisation is manifest, but it's very convenient because it looks like it's the NHS that doesn't work. It looks like it's the principle of publicly funded, provided and owned healthcare, which doesn't work. What people can't see is everything we've discussed behind the scenes, that it doesn't work because tens of billions are being siphoned off to running a market system, to the PFI debt, to outsourcing profits, to management consultants.
So 2,500 years ago, this woman was walking on the streets of Babylon, and she sees a frog, and the frog says, "Lady, please pick me up and give me a kiss. I will turn into the most beautiful, handsome prince you've ever seen."
This is Ali Pasa, a former Goldman Sachs trader and super salesman who claims he is starting a world revolution in healthcare.
Not just us. We're about to change everything about healthcare. It's going to become completely democratized, maybe not in the next 2-5 years, but certainly in the next 10 years. It's going to become accessible, it's going to be affordable, it's going to be everywhere. Right?
Ali Pasa became a national figure in Britain when his company, Circle Health, won a contract to run Hinchingbrook Hospital in Cambridgeshire from 2012. It was an historic moment for the NHS, the first NHS hospital to be effectively sold off.
We were classed as a failing hospital, so we were informed that this great businessman was coming in.
Ali Pasa.
Yes, and I must admit, when I first met him, I thought, what a charismatic, inspiring man we have here. You know, that's how he came across. And he said, "So you have my expertise, and I am going to take this hospital to great heights. You are going to be the best hospital in the UK. Dream the impossible." That's what he kept saying.
As he kept saying, dream the impossible.
Dream the impossible, yes.
Okay.
Yes. We had a meeting where Vince Cable, the then business secretary, attended. And he was obviously very, very friendly with Ali Pasa, so they came up together. And Mr. Cable came and he sat opposite me. And he was talking very, very businesslike. And he said to me, "Do not have any doubts about Mr. Pasa's ability. He will make this hospital fly as a business. It will thrive as a business." It was all this business. Mm. And I looked at him and I said, "You know, I don't mean to be rude or anything, but this is a hospital. It's the NHS. I don't see it as a business."
And yes. What reaction did you
get? He said, "Yes, it is, my dear. It is a business."
We asked Vince Cable for a response. He says he has no recollection of the conversation. The selling of Hinchingbrook Hospital is a story of propaganda. This is how the BBC's Newsnight reported the exciting prospect of Britain's first privatised NHS hospital.
For the first time in the UK, a district general hospital was given over to a private sector organisation to manage. 6 months on from the start of that experiment, Newsnight has been given exclusive access to Hinchinbrook to find out what's changed.
So in one of our wards in here, we're getting 100% satisfaction of our patients.
There is still a way to go. Nevertheless, at Hinchinbrook, they're celebrating the sixth-month milestone with cupcakes.
We're feeling that now. We're satisfied with looking after every single one of our patients.
These partner meetings are a big part of the turnaround strategy. They're called partner meetings because the staff now own 49% of the company. That's part of the plan, reigniting and then harnessing their creative enthusiasm.
Our response to that was that every person that worked at that hospital and the local community already had a stake in that hospital. They didn't need to become shareholders in some fantasy scheme.
And to be honest, I didn't want to be a part of that. That didn't sit right with me. And I actually said that. I said, "I don't want to have shares." I said, "This is the NHS. I just want to do my job."
It was a 10-year contract. They promised absolutely astonishing levels of savings. It was absolutely incredible. It was something in the region of 300 million over 10 years. They sold this idea that they were going to get all the staff working in the new corporate way. And so they gave them all new uniforms. So they no longer had NHS uniforms. They were Circle Hinchingbrook uniforms.
They decided that as lead nurses, we would then, on top of our jobs, we would meet daily and go round all of the wards, our own wards, and look very carefully. You know, it would take an hour or so of our working life to look into the patients to see if we could actually get them out quicker. And we used to have to do that and have our results back for circle by 1 o'clock every day as to how many patients we could move out. So that we could accommodate the planned admissions, and the planned admissions are the ones that bring the money in. And the sad thing was, as lead nurses, we were all put up against each other. So there were six of us, and we all used to work really well before circle, but because of the nature of it, it became very competitive. You know, in the performance meetings and in the operational meetings, it was a competition. And we therefore, that cohesiveness didn't exist anymore.
So if you still had patients blocking beds, as they say, then you would be failing in this competitive situation.
Well, yes. And I was always a failure. I was always told that, you know. So it gets to you when you're being told that.
But before 2012 was over, Ali Pasa had stepped down, taking a contractual payment of more than £500,000. In 2015, a Care Quality Commission report revealed that the safety of patients at Hinchingbrook, including children, was at risk. Circle disputed the report and says it won a national award for patient care.
The Care Quality Commission were brought in, and there was a damning report produced. So bad, in fact, that they put the hospital, for the first time that they'd had to do this, in special measures. Circle withdrew from the contract. A dramatic failure in terms of the privatisation project.
In 2015, Circle abandoned Hinchingbrook, which returned to NHS control.
Why were these people allowed to run a hospital? Because what happened when they withdrew 3 years into a 10-year contract, the NHS was left to pick up not only the financial damage, but the damage it caused to the local community and to the staff who had had to work through these 3 years of incompetence.
One day I came into work as usual, and my brain had just switched off. My bleep kept going off and I couldn't remember how to recall my bleep. It was as if my brain had gone. Couldn't function.
Oh. So, yeah. It's okay. It's okay.
Risa.
It's a very painful memory. It's a job you loved.
So it was really sad because I'd worked there so long.
How long?
24 years. And I'd lost my extended family.
Yeah.
If you know what I mean. The patients and the doctors, and it was a part of my life and it was just gone.
Hinchinbrook and the Circle debacle should be in stone given to any Secretary of State for Health in terms of what could go wrong, did go wrong. Privateers have no place in the NHS. They are there to make a profit. And, you know, patient care and health is not about making a profit.
Well, doing that,
I asked Ali Pasa for an interview, but his spokesman declined. Here is Ali Pasa again, promoting what he called his next project, a company called Babylon Health and its app GP at Hand. This gives you a doctor on your smartphone or a robot. This is the Conservative Health Secretary, Matt Hancock, who believes technology offers a new utopia for the NHS. He's one of Babylon's biggest fans. Secretary of State for Health, Matt Hancock, is very keen on this.
Well, I suppose he is, but I mean, you know, I don't have much confidence in this guy's ability or his judgment. I mean, he just, you know, he also appeared in that crazy advertorial, didn't he? I mean, that's the other thing. You know, a big question about what is his links with this company? He's prepared to appear in an Evening Standard double spread paid for by GP at hand, paid for by Babylon. I mean, that is just questionable, I would say, and to give personal endorsement to one particular piece of software.
I think if you're looking at the cost of the NHS and somebody comes along and says, I've got a bit of technology here that can replace an awful lot of expensive clinicians and do their job just as well or better, particularly if you're already biased towards tech, you might be uncritically enthusiastic, which I think Matt Hancock has been. So,
in its long-term plan for the NHS, the government wants to replace thousands of GPs with consultations by video and app and robot.
This young woman, let's call her Illy, isn't feeling well. But she doesn't go to the doctor's office. He comes to her via an app called Babylon Health.
Hello.
Hello there, this is Dr. Butt from Babylon. Thanks very much for choosing us for your consultation today. How can I help? The
last few days. Ellie explains that her eyes itch.
Why do you think so many of your colleagues in the medical profession have expressed quite serious doubts about Babylon?
So I think those doubts will be very quickly dispelled by some of the recent reports that have been published. So you may have seen that there was a report published by the regulator, the Care Quality Commission, who inspected our services and found them to be good. There's also been a report published yesterday. This is an NHS England commissioned report, an independent evaluation, that has shown overwhelmingly that patients and GPs are really satisfied with these services.
I mean, there'd be quite some claims. The claim that your chatbot achieved a higher score in a medical exam than human doctors. I mean, that wasn't true, was it?
So it was true for the test that we did. So
the test itself was extraordinary, according to doctors working for you, I think, at the time, answered only something like 15 of 50 questions. And yet Babylon claimed, as a result of that, that the chatbot had intelligence equivalence with human doctors.
What we found, which was really interesting, is actually there's a huge amount of variation in actual human doctor performance, so when it comes to accuracy, and that ranged from as low as 64% right up to 94%, with an average of 80%. And then when we did the same testing with our AI products, we were able to show that the AI performed at about 80%.
You've said that the majority of the medical profession are, and I think the word you use, are askance at Babylon's virtual doctor. What's wrong with it?
I think probably the bottom line is it's a completely mistaken idea. So it's based on the idea that you can reduce people's health problems down to perhaps some very simple sort of yes-no questions, predictably churn those through a machine and come up with the right answer every time. I think there are two big issues with that. Number one, it doesn't work a lot of the time for anything that's more than very straightforward. So when I'm consulting with patients, they may come with the same kind of symptom. And what I try and do is I try and understand what it is that's worrying them and what I need to do to be able to address their particular concerns. So it's less about the symptom and more about the person who's got it.
I mean, the advertising standards has picked you up on a number of things described as misleading. One of them was it was 100% safe or 100% the best in the world.
So I think sometimes things are taken out of context, and that example that you cite of 100% safe is actually accurate, but it's 100% safe in the test that we performed. Now, that doesn't, of course, mean...
Is anything 100%
well,
safe?
Well, that's a good point. But, you know, and that's why it's very important, that's why I'm saying, you know, that it's all about the detail. So, actually, in the particular test, the results showed it was 100% safe. But that, of course, doesn't mean it's 100% safe all of the time. And as you rightfully point out, can anything be 100% safe?
I mean, medicine is a science, but it's an art, it's a humanity. And machines have no emotional intelligence. They cannot understand people. They can't understand metaphor. They can't... you know, probably the majority of what my patients communicate to me, they communicate not in words, but in what they do with their body, what they don't say, how they choose to answer my question. And I'm constantly understanding them through communication that's nothing to do with words. And again, a machine cannot understand human communication in that way. What we say in words is actually only a very small part, the minority of what we're actually trying to say.
I mean, Babylon is the progeny of Circle Health. Circle Health has a rather notorious reputation. And I don't need to go over the details, but it took over Hinchingbrook Hospital, and you talked about the Care Quality Commission giving you a good report. Well, it gave it Hinchingbrook, after Circle had been there, its worst report.
Of course, I can't really speak on behalf of Circle, not having had anything to do with that organisation. What I do know is, you know, our founder, Dr. Ali Pasa, as you mentioned, actually, you know, did some really amazing transformative things in Circle, and took the hospital you mentioned, Hinchingbrook, from being a failing hospital to actually being a highly performing hospital. Now,
no, that's, excuse me.
But things
Dr.
changed
Bart, that's
after
not
he
true.
Left.
It didn't become highly performing.
And I mean, I can't obviously specifically comment on Circle, but what I can comment on with great confidence is Babylon as an organisation. Yeah. And actually, you know, I can't commend Dr. Pass enough for his leadership. You know, if you think about the success of Babylon and everything that we've managed to achieve to transform patient care here in the UK and beyond.
You have words and you have actions. Mm. And the actions are taking us further and further towards an American model. The words keep spouting out the rhetoric, but the actions are taking us further away from that public good towards the kind of American model. So the actions are what tell us what's going on.
This is Chicago's all-news station. News Radio 780 and 105.9 FM and CBSChicago.com.
WBBM News Time, 10:53. The News Watch continues.
Lifting Chicago several tons...
Chicago is one of America's wealthiest cities. Article 25 of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights says that everyone has the right to a standard of living adequate for the health and well-being of a family, including food, clothing, housing, and medical care. In the United States, that right has yet to be granted. Instead, a group of health insurance companies dominate the healthcare industry and often decide who shall live or die. As many as 87 million Americans cannot afford health insurance, or their insurance is made virtually worthless by excess charges known as deductibles. At least 20,000 Americans die every year because they can't get treatment. And this is the system that inspires so-called reform of the NHS.
It happens late at night, after 10 and before 4. It's called patient dumping.
This woman says it happened to her, dumped at a homeless shelter by a nursing home alone.
Had you ever heard of patient dumping before?
Never.
She says two men in a white van drove her here to the Pacific Garden Mission and dumped her right here at the mission's front gate. It was the middle of the night. She was in a wheelchair, and she didn't have her medication.
For any society, just to drop somebody off, especially with a disability, and expect them to fend for themselves is really barbaric. And when we saw these things happening, we were appalled at that practice.
In the United States, the dumping of patients is so common that this hospital patient was caught on CCTV being dumped at a refuge.
People just want to get rid of the person. And at whatever cost, find some place where somebody can go to and just dump them and get out of there. Let's move on to the next person. And if a hospital wants to make the most profit, they want to get the most number of people in the beds. So to get somebody out and get the next person in, find a place for a person to go to. And if you can't, dump them off. Because they know that an organization like ours, you know, we wouldn't leave them out there. Yeah. So they're really trusting the goodwill of the organization.
On the other side of Chicago, in what is known as Skid Row, is Franciscan House, a former broom factory that's another refuge for the unwanted sick dumped by hospitals.
Right now, let me see. We're walking.
They do their best here, but it feels like a warehouse for expendable people.
When this is full, how many does it
This dorm here is 148.
Right.
All right.
What happens to people who have no health insurance or maybe have health insurance, but it's not adequate?
So it's not like the hospital calls us and says, you know, this person's coming
we're
over.
We're going to dump a patient.
And this is these are the issues, all right? No. Their driver is going to come by the front door and is ready to just drop them off right there. Some of them have possibly had some surgery. Some of them might be psychiatric patients.
Yeah.
Sometimes we have to call an ambulance to have them readmitted to a hospital because they're just not well enough to navigate the place on their own. But sometimes we're nowhere near the door and the person gets dropped off.
And so they can be very quick and...
It doesn't take much to open the door and let somebody out.
Wendell Potter was the chief public relations executive of Cigna, a giant health insurance company. His job was to spin the company's propaganda, often, as he describes, with deadly effect.
You were the spokesman, the public voice for a health insurance industry whose routine practices, and I quote you, amount to a death sentence for thousands of Americans every year.
Yeah.
That's an extraordinary statement. Could you talk a little bit about
that? It's not extraordinary when you look at the reality of our healthcare system. That happens all the time. Every day, decisions are made by insurance company employees as to whether or not you'll get some life-saving care. There was one case in particular. It involved a 17-year-old girl in Los Angeles who needed a liver transplant. And her doctors at UCLA Medical Center said they felt the chances were significantly good that she would come through the surgery and live many years.
Just remind me of her name.
Her name was Nataline Sarkeesian. And there was a medical doctor at Cigna, 2,500 miles away in Pittsburgh, who looked at the request for prior authorization, which is, again, a term that is prevalent in our system. Doctors have to ask insurance companies in advance for permission to proceed with a procedure, or at least to get coverage for it, or some assurance that it'll be paid for. So that was what happened. The doctors who attended and were going to be doing the surgery asked Cigna, and a medical director said he didn't think it was medically appropriate for Natalie.
What did that mean, medically appropriate?
Well, even though the policy covered transplants, in his subjective opinion, he said he did not think that her doctors were correct. He had never seen Natalie. He had never examined her. Keep in mind that a perfect match had been found, and the liver, the transplant had been scheduled, and the family came into the hospital on the morning that the transplant was to have been done, thinking that it would be done. But instead, one of the doctors took the family aside, took the parents aside, and said, "We're sorry, but we've not gotten clearance from Cigna."
Hmm.
So the family decided they would try to make a big media case out of this.
So what happened?
It became very clear to the company that this was not a media story that was just going to go away quietly, as I was often able to make them go away. They, within an hour or so, convened, they being the CEO and the president of our healthcare division, the chief medical officer, and a few others, on a conference call, decided, well, maybe in this case we can make an exception. She was getting sicker by the day. Her other organs began to shut down, and she died about 5 hours after Cigna said it would pay for the transplant. And I just said, I am in the wrong line of work. I can't keep doing this. My job was to help perpetuate a very, very unfair, expensive, and dysfunctional system.
What kind of wealth did that company have at its disposal then?
There are a lot of executives close to the CEO level who make millions of dollars a year. Billions of dollars flow through these companies. They make billions of dollars in profits off of that revenue, partly to reward shareholders, or largely to reward shareholders. But a lot of the money is skimmed off or made available to conduct PR campaigns and lobbying campaigns.
In 1996, Dr. Linda Pino, who worked for the insurance giant Humana, appeared before a congressional committee with this remarkable confession.
I am here primarily today to make a public confession. In the spring of 1987, as a physician, I denied a man a necessary operation that would have saved his life and thus caused his death. No person and no group has held me accountable for this, because in fact what I did was I saved a company $500,000 for this. And furthermore, this particular act secured my reputation as a good medical director, and it ensured my continued advancement in the healthcare field. I went from making a few $100s a week as a medical reviewer to an escalating six-figure income as a physician executive. In all my work, I had one primary duty, and that was to use my medical expertise for the financial benefit of the organization for which I worked.
This was one of those cases where the request came in. It was just a little piece of paper in my inbox. I just happened to pick it up next, and it just happened to come to me. And they had called from a hospital in California. A patient from Nevada had been on a transplant list.
Heart transplant.
They had a heart became available, a match.
Yeah.
And the surgeon was ready to operate. So I called, and I thought this is just a formality, because nobody would do a medically unnecessary heart transplant. You couldn't get through the transplant process. So I talked to him, he explained the situation, they had a heart available, they called him, they got him, you know, to this hospital. So I approved it. So I stamped my little approve on it, and then just everything went to hell because it was $500,000 transplant. So then all these people start rushing in. We got to figure out a way to deny it. We can't pay for it. You got to call the doctor back. I'm a physician. I know what the consequences are going to be to this man who doesn't get his heart. He's going to continue to deteriorate, and his congestive heart failure could last 2 days, 2 years, but he's been consigned to cardiac hell. I mean, he's going to slowly deteriorate. And whether he died 2 days later or 2 years later, you know, I participated in consigning this man to death. I mean, I signed his death warrant. I would try to do the best thing I could do as a physician, but I was always coming up against this huge machine that was just grinding away to keep patients from getting what they needed, because that costs money. I mean, the whole purpose was to make money. That's the risk for all these other attempts at privatizing portions of something like the NHS, is when you begin to hand over the benefits, the funds, to these private companies to manage. I mean, their goal is going to be to make money, not to provide better care or more care or appropriate care.
This is the town of Wise, Virginia, in the mountain country of Appalachia, where some of the poorest Americans live. The coal mines once gave people here a precarious life. Today, many are unemployed and unwell. Every summer, an extraordinary event comes to Wise, offering free health care of a kind unknown in the United States. This is remote area medical, known as RAM.
It's a wonderful community that comes together and actually looks out for each other. Yeah. They come in, we greet them in the morning, starting at 5-6 o'clock in the morning. To come through and we register them. We don't ask them identifying questions. Yeah. We don't care if they have insurance. We don't care their income, demographics. We just ask them, where does it hurt and how can we help you?
RAM is like a pop-up wartime field hospital run entirely by volunteers and set up in an agricultural showground. It's as if the NHS has come to town. People wait for days for the clinics to open, sleeping in their cars. Most of them have no other hope of medical care.
You're going to stay in the car tonight?
Yep.
Yeah. So who are you seeing tomorrow?
Dental tomorrow.
You got some urgent problems?
I actually chipped a tooth a week ago, and he's got a feeling she's just got a cleaning because the school does free stuff for the middle school.
Are they asleep in there?
He's out. It's actually peaceful here, so.
It is peaceful, isn't it?
We're supposed to meet up with the plastic surgeon that did her removal of her little bump on her head last year, and so he could see a follow-up of what it looks like this year, so he could see how it turned out, so.
Okay, what would that have cost you to have
Probably several thousand, especially to get somebody like him, because he's actually a really well-known plastic surgeon from Charlotte, so. To get him would probably several thousand dollars.
Several thousand dollars?
Yes.
Whereas here you get it for free.
Mm-hmm.
My sister is actually utilizing this because she has no health insurance and she's a veteran still fighting to get benefits for that. And so we brought her here to get dental work because she can't afford health insurance.
What? Can't tell you how happy I am to be here right now because I have some abscess teeth that I've been dealing with for the last couple of years. And
so you're going to have your teeth looked at?
And I have Crohn's disease.
You have Crohn's disease.
I have Crohn's. I have a lot of medical issues too, and I've been off my medication because I can't afford it. without
health insurance. What does your medication cost?
See, the last time I had it was about 6 years ago, and just for two bottles, they were $490-something a piece.
Oh, and that would, how long would that last you?
That would last me a month. And that's only part of my meds. Oh. My cholesterol's high.
I'm about $1,500,000 in debt for medical bills, but I've been sued. My credit is destroyed from medical bills.
Right.
And so I couldn't even buy one room. My credit is so bad. I've been sued and I just don't pay them. I can't.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah.
This is wonderful because Appalachia really needs these kind of clinics and I didn't know about them till 2 years ago. And tonight we're just going to sit in the car all night and wait.
So you're sleeping here tonight?
Yes.
Yeah.
Sir.
And you've got your ticket for tomorrow.
Yep.
Tell me why you're here, then.
Glasses and dental.
Mm-hmm. You're getting a full health checkup.
Mm-hmm.
Why do you feel you need that? Yeah.
Well, diabetes runs rampant in my family. So with this service, it gives the opportunity to stay one step ahead of it.
Yeah. What are you mostly concerned about?
Neck, back, 7 bulging discs, permanent pinched nerve in my back, and there's nothing they can do surgical-wise to make it better. So I miss out so there helping people. But
you have a lot of pain, then?
Yeah, a lot of pain. Yeah.
And who will you see tomorrow?
I'll be seeing the neurosurgeons and those people in the medical and then over to vision to get my vision done, because I got glaucoma on my left eye.
What would that cost you to get that kind of treatment outside?
Outside, you're looking at just for the surgical part about $1,000 each visit, somewhere around there. So this is like one of the best things here, vision-wise, that they do every year.
It's only this free healthcare here that offers you some kind of solution.
It helps a lot, not just me, my wife, everyone else that's here that's camping out tonight.
I wish you well for tomorrow.
Thank you.
And that everything goes
y'all too
really to plan for you and your wife.
Thank you.
It's 6 a.m. and the sun is just coming up. Everyone has a number.
Anybody with a numbered admission ticket below 40?
Yeah, I know you're cheerleading.
Meaning it's written within 41, 42, 43, 44, 45. We're offering mammograms, pap smears. We're taking chest x-rays. We're doing EKGs inside.
Can I ask you why you're here?
I work at a gas station. And for me to get insurance for me and my husband is over $200. That's just for vision and dental. I can't afford that, making $8 an hour. You just can't.
Would you like to see a free public health service right throughout the United States?
I really would. I thought Trump was going to get it done, but I guess that flopped a little. To have to go out of another state to get health care is health services.
Did you sleep in the car last night?
No, honey, actually.
What, 3:30. 4 in the morning? It took us a couple hours drive.
And I worked till 1:30 this morning.
Oh.
Yeah.
RAM was founded in 1985 by the late Stan Brock, a Londoner who believed passionately in the right of people to health care regardless of their ability to pay.
Stan was the world's expert on free health care. It had to be free. It had to be real care, high quality. He didn't want us to tell somebody to go find a doctor or a dentist. Stan was the guy who could inspire the workers. He could inspire the volunteers. And his words were simple. We need you. And that is why you folks are gathered here today. And in Stan's honor, we will never forget the mission.
This is one of the most economically deprived parts of America. The coal industry boomed in years past and has mostly declined. We have some counties out here that have no dentist, and there are lots of specialties that we don't have at all that cities take for granted.
The nurse practitioner at the health wagon wanted me to come because I have chest pain sometimes, and my blood pressure is, like, uncontrollable.
Okay, can you describe your chest pain? What kind of a pain
is
that?
Well, sometimes it hurts, like a dull heart down my arms, and some. But this morning it's just been like sharp twinges.
Do you smoke?
Yes.
We're a belt of disease. We're a belt of lung disease. I'm a pulmonologist. So we're a belt of asthma, COPD, smoking. We're a belt of lung cancer. We're a belt of heart disease, stroke. We're a belt of obesity. And we're a belt of opioid use tied into mental health issues.
So when they come to you, what typically do they come with?
They're short of breath, they have a cough, they have exercise limitation, they're having difficulty working, and we can do a chest x-ray on the mobile unit. We can do a breathing test, a pulmonary function.
Are you able to catch disease in time?
We did find 3 lung cancers in one day here at this event. And so we do find serious disease with chest x-ray and or other screenings. But the most common thing we find is of course the common diseases, discovering high blood pressure, discovering diabetes. And we discover things that they have no idea about. A lot of the patients know they don't feel very well, but they don't know why. They're trying to cope, trying to exist. Diabetes is a disease that people tend to deny. They don't even like the word diabetes. In the mountains, they'll say, got a little sugar. They won't say the word diabetes. And they're trying to cope by putting off till tomorrow what they can't afford today.
It's a bit of a lifesaver here, isn't it?
Yeah. This is a great program. Yeah. Fantastic program. Yeah.
I mean, what were the people who live around here who don't have the medical facilities?
They do without.
Yeah, they do without.
They have no teeth or partial teeth. They have no diabetic treatment, no high blood pressure treatment. So if they come here, they at least get some medicine.
Typically, what are you dealing with here? What are you treating?
We've seen several patients this morning that have received more than 10 extractions.
Well, the reason these people are here because they can't afford to go to the dentist.
They can't afford to go to the dentist, or they have insurance that really isn't working for them. Some of these people who work in these small communities, their insurance may only be acceptable in a regional area. Go outside that region, the insurance isn't accepted.
It just sounds like chaos.
It is. It's chaos and it's a vicious cycle. And that's why things like these are so important.
Sandbrock was quoted yesterday about the famous quote of all health care should be free.
Right. Yeah, I don't deny that. I don't disagree with that. And people are suffering. It doesn't make much sense to me as a human being.
When and how is there going to be free health care in the United States?
Not in my lifetime.
And our pharmaceuticals are unbelievably expensive, the highest cost for drugs in the world. In other countries, I can get medicine. I can go to India and buy medicine for pennies and give it out to patients. But here, when I, as a charitable doctor, go to get one asthma inhaler for one patient, that's $400 for 1 month's supply for an asthma patient when 6% of our population has asthma. It's like an incredible ripoff.
And then they were gone, wrapped up in a few hours. The lesson for us on the other side of the Atlantic could not be clearer. Could the NHS be reduced to charity
that comes and goes, like this extraordinary event in Virginia. This is the City of London, home to some of the world's richest money movers, gamblers, insurance companies, hedge funds, and banks. It was here and in Wall Street that the great financial crash of 2008 was caused by a system of greed, mismanagement, and corruption, most of it rescued by the government. And it was here that the imposition of an extreme ideology called austerity was justified. Austerity is one of the propaganda triumphs of the age, because there's no need for austerity. There is a debt owed by banks that were bailed out with our money. We the people don't owe a penny. Then why are we paying for it? Why are the poorest picking up the bill when some of the biggest companies in the world pay little or no tax? Why has mass poverty returned to Britain? Why are the very premises of civilized life, of which the National Health Service is a beacon, being run down or put up for sale? Why, according to one study, is there the greatest rise in mortality in 50 years? The study undertaken by you and your colleagues gave up some really damning evidence that thousands of excess deaths in England and Wales were linked to cuts in the health service. In the first 7 weeks of 2018, an additional person died every 7 minutes.
The only thing that fits is austerity, the cuts. Cuts to the health service, but cuts to social care as well. Because as the cuts got deeper and deeper, people began to die faster. The frail and the elderly first. Elderly women who are much more likely to be living on their own than elderly men. And we first said this over 4 years ago. And the cuts continued. And then life expectancy itself began to drop. You're talking about 120,000 people so far who have died earlier than they would otherwise. For child and infant mortality, we're neonatal deaths, we're 19th in Europe. And that's getting worse. One thing that shocks medics, our babies used to have a three times better chance of not dying than babies in Portugal in the 60s and 70s. Portugal was always put forward as a terrible place to be born. Now you're much more likely to get to your first birthday if you're born in Portugal than in the UK.
The changes in the health service have a great deal to do with privatization.
Yeah.
The change of the character of the health service has much to do with that.
Yeah.
And in making this film, we found that it's much more prevalent,
yeah,
certainly than I realized. Mm. What's the impact of that?
When you think you're part of something which is truly precious to people, that's when you work longer hours that you're not paid for. That's when you spend another minute with somebody that you wouldn't otherwise. Mm. Turn it into a business where their customers are not patients. And, you know, the same way that most people treat their jobs, it's how you get paid, but it's not a vocation. And that's very dangerous with health, because you really want the people looking after your health to actually care about you, not care about when they're going to be going off shift.
On Clapham Common in London is Glassdoor, a voluntary organisation giving refuge and food to homeless people. For some of the people here, their predicament bears a striking likeness to patient dumping in the United States.
We're getting a lot of emergency discharges from local hospitals. We're getting a lot of people who have been seen by their local mental health units and been told that although they do have a mental health problem, they don't meet the threshold for care. We've had people who have arrived literally in scrubs and open-toed sandals from mental health units where there's been a sort of discharge meeting on at sort of 10 o'clock in the morning, 5 o'clock in the afternoon, they're put in a taxi and sent down to us. Last year we had a man who had been discharged from the local hospital 9 days after having open heart surgery. We have NHS workers who are homeless. You know, it's a testament to their staggering loyalty that even though they are sleeping rough, they'll get up at 7 o'clock in the morning, dust themselves off and go into work.
They go and work in the NHS?
Yes.
Having slept rough?
Having slept rough, yep. We have care workers, we have healthcare assistants, the people who go out and do personal care for our aging relatives, our sick individuals, have oftentimes been sleeping on a church floor the night before.
This is St. Stephen's Church in the heart of London, just behind the Houses of Parliament. It's midwinter. And this is David Coombe, whose remarkable organisation, Street Souls, cares for the victims of austerity. With hot meals, clothes, glasses that people can no longer afford, and above all, a warm place where people can feel human again. David, just describe Street Souls and how it began.
What I really wanted to do was a compassionate act involving my two younger children at the time, who I think were 6 and 8 maybe at the time. And I said to them, just before Christmas, I said, we're not going to buy Christmas presents this year, boys. We're going to buy sleeping bags for the homeless people, and we're going to take soup and sandwiches out to the homeless, which, of course, didn't go down too well, as you can imagine, with young lads. We got a big van full up with sandwiches and soup and literally drove around London, and we did this several times.
What struck you at first about the people you met?
That they were just like me. One thing that was very apparent was it's not as portrayed in the media.
Yeah.
There's not drunk, everyone's not drunk, everyone's not a drug addict. In fact, I'd say that was a minority, you know. Totally the opposite of what most people would probably believe. A lot of these people just had misfortunate events in their lives.
That direct connection between political decisions and homelessness, that's something you see, isn't it?
Yeah, very much so. You know, in 2010, Westminster City Council tried to pass a bylaw within central Westminster to make it illegal to sleep rough and punishable by, I think it's a tariff 5 fine of £500, you know, which is kind of crazy. A homeless person's not going to have £500, but also illegal to feed homeless people.
What's the direct connection between austerity and the people that you help here?
The lack of aftercare is something that I've noticed. You know, some of the guys we have here have had some quite major operations, are effectively turfed back out on the streets.
Give me an example.
Well, I've got a fella who has had a couple of knee operations, and he's what he calls home is a janitor's closet of 7 foot by 4 foot in a block of flats, you know, and that's where he goes. That's where he convalesces. Another lovely chap who had, I'm not sure what surgery, but major surgery, so his chest looked rather like a sort of a quilt, had to go in a place he was given 5 stories up with no lift, immediately having this operation where he had 140 stitches or whatever. And it's just so wrong. It's, you know, it's in out, you know, it's free up the beds and, you know. You know, the life expectancy on the street is 47 years old, you know.
47.
It's heartbreaking because the bar is set so high now on who you can admit to hospital because there are so few hospital beds. You know, it really is a case that unless you're threatening to imminently kill yourself or you're psychotic to the point of just incredibly disturbed as an individual or a threat to other people, then you're sent home. And unless
What if home is not a home? What if it's in the streets?
Well, it's just heartbreaking. I mean, there's been a lot of occasions when I've had to send someone out onto the streets, and you just send them out into the night and you don't know what's going to happen to them.
John Watts works with David Coombe as a volunteer. We're on his regular run to check on people with nowhere to sleep in near freezing temperatures, but on the streets.
We've created a have and have not society. And we don't like to particularly see ones who have not.
David was saying that life expectancy of people on the streets was 47.
Yeah.
How long has he been there, do you think?
Months.
Months?
Excuse me, have you parked the car?
I'm parked the street, soul.
Have you got a spare sleeping bag? I need to get one. I've just come out of the jail.
I've got one sleeping bag left.
Are you?
All right.
Baby, I haven't got one. Please.
I'll be back in 2 weeks. Yep.
One, you can't use the toilet. Two, you can't get housing. Three, we're having a nervous breakdown. And it's not good.
It's wrong.
What happens to their health?
It deteriorates rapidly. They suffer from all sorts of things, and their mental health suffers. They don't sleep enough. They only get a couple of hours sleep because they're either moved on or they're nervous about people. And it's just a downward spiral, basically.
Yeah. For those who are not used to being homeless, to sleeping on a cold pavement, that must be a shock.
I think it would be a shock for anybody.
Anybody.
It's bad enough in the summer and in this weather and in these temperatures.
Yeah.
I just find it unbelievable in the 21st century.
Why is this happening in 2019, middle of London?
Sorry.
We stop filming when the frustration of one rough sleeper spills over.
Fuck off!
Okay. Sorry.
Okay.
Sorry. For more than 6 months, we've phoned, texted, emailed, and wrote to government ministers and officials who run the National Health Service. The Secretary of State, Matt Hancock, the head of NHS England, Simon Stephens, the chair of NHS England, Lord Prior, the Health Minister, Caroline Dynage, the former Prime Minister, David Cameron, the former Health Secretary, Alan Milburn, and many other officials and politicians. No one responsible for the future of the NHS was available to be interviewed on the urgent issues raised in this film. Silence.
If you start out with a core, a principle of wanting to care for everybody, you know, you've already started at a foundation of value. And, I mean, we've never really had that here. You know, there's never been, you know, a healthcare system that started with ethical values and said, okay, healthcare is a right. or, you know, certain other values. We've never started there and built on it so that we have a lens by which we can measure everything that's happening. You do. You have that. And if you lose that, then you'll never get it back.
We gained the freedom from fear in the past. This enormous sense of relief from thinking you are no longer going to be a burden on your family. You're no longer, not just having to fear for yourself and your own pain and suffering, but the idea that your family would either have to try and look after you or find the money for somebody to treat you. And it was one of the most remarkable and rapid improvements in living standards and quality of life. That fear has come back again.
It was a political decision to give us an NHS, and we got that in 1948 with the 1946 Act. It was a political decision to take it away in 2012. It only needs a political decision and the will of the people and the politicians, because the people have not lost faith with the NHS. They want an NHS.
I believe they will reach a tipping point of public awareness, at which time our politicians cannot get away with the deception any longer. If enough of the general public stand up and say no more of this, if the profession can unite and realise the power they have, we can stop this very quickly.
The government need to believe in the NHS, not mess about with it. They need to properly fund it. And they need to trust those that are there to get on with their work and let them get on with their work.
People like you.
Yes. Yeah. To trust us.